So we have a pretty awesome group with a pretty extensive background in all kinds of IoT here. Starting from the far side, Bill is a veteran in embedded system security. He spent some time with the NSA before moving on to secure a few municipal water systems and America's largest HMO against a variety of hacking attacks, sitting next to him with the helmet. Carlo used to be the director of new business strategy at Texas Instruments, who I'm sure you're all familiar with, and he's now the founder of a wearables-focused company called Safi Beats. Next to him is Matt, who is the director of software and electronics at Autodesk down at Pier 9, the new beautiful Autodesk space in San Francisco. So if any of you have used Eagle 123 or Tinkercad, I know I have, you can thank Matt for that. And then finally, Mike, right here next to me, runs the IoT studio for Orange Telecom. So he's in charge of experimenting with all kinds of crazy new industrial and consumer IoT technologies, which is actually a great segue into the first question I wanted to ask, which is, from an investor perspective, you know, we look at a lot of IoT companies, and there seems to be a distinction that's solidified more recently, which is we have industrial IoT companies, or Industry 4.0 if you're European, and consumer IoT companies. And we see some entrepreneurs struggling a little bit in trying to nail down the priorities and the important features that these two distinct groups of customers need. And so given your experience, like, how do you see the difference between these two distinct segments, and what should entrepreneurs know when they're trying to tackle one or the other?
I can jump in. Sure, so I'll jump in. So I think, just to reframe the question, it's, you know, if you're an entrepreneur and you want to start a company and you love IoT and you're thinking, do I go B2B or B2C, or B2B is basically industrial IoT, how do I think about it? To me, it's really, it's all about the user, and it's all about understanding essentially how many users are you dealing with. I'll just simplify consumer IoT and say what's nice about consumer IoT is the same person who uses your product is the same person who pays for your product, you know, family IoT devices notwithstanding. But almost all the time, you know, the person who buys the Alexa is the person who listens to music on the Alexa, who sets all the timers and everything else, or at least is the champion of that device, even if there are other users. Whereas on, I think, the industrial IoT side, you're looking at a much more complex group of stakeholders, not just core users. So, you know, if we're looking at something more like inventory tracking, if this is a large system, the CFO is probably gonna have to sign off on it and is gonna wanna see that there's a true ROI for the money that they're putting into that system. But that's gonna be different than the guy on the shop floor who's gonna be using that system to maintain inventory. And so I think as an entrepreneur, when I advise them to how to approach these things, it's really making sure that you understand who are your users, who are your stakeholders, and how do you make sure that you get buy-in from the most important ones.
From my point of view, essentially, when you go in an industrial application, it's all about cost, efficiency, and benefits. So essentially, you have a very rational approach to what is essentially the implication of user specific products in your process. And even the level of investment is huge and is bigger. So unless you are capable to justify, essentially, you know, the use of that new technology in your industrial environment, of course, you know, you're gonna find your barrier to entrance. For what it is instead, the consumer product, it's really about, you know, how much your solution is going to change their life and how much essentially that adoption rate essentially is gonna be easier for the customer to use, you know. So they really imagine what is gonna happen every day in what they're doing. So it's a totally different approach, of course, from the customer point of view. And of course, you know, today we are all market driven. From the producer point of view, you know, or the, you know, developer point of view, of course, on one end you need to have the understanding of what is essentially the decision making in the market, but on the other end also you have to figure out, you know, where is the importance in terms of how you allocate the cost in terms of what is going to be the cost of your final product. Probably having a super cheap you know, device in consumer market, it may not be so important if you fit with the right, you know, lifestyle that you are targeting. While instead in the industrial market, essentially the right cost structure, of course, it needs to be something very good to start with.
So I'm actually going to put you on the spot a little bit because clearly you moved from an industrial-focused IoT company to now running your own consumer-focused IoT company.
Sure.
And I think if we all read the press, there's been huge amounts of money sunk into HomeKit, Alexa, Nest, and SmartThings. But the adoption hasn't really taken off, right? Like, so it doesn't feel like any one of these systems is really winning. It doesn't feel like there's a strong pull towards any system. And I remember looking at SmartThings as an investment back in 2012, right? And so what is it that's stopping mass consumer adoption of smart homes and IoT technology?
I don't know if you.
But. Well, I was just going to kind of raise a sort of controversial, make a somewhat provocative statement and say that, you know, I don't know that consumers really care about IoT. I don't think anybody knocks on my door and says, you know what, I can't wait until I get this device connected to the internet. I think ultimately it's about transforming the user experience. And then it's also, as a company producing a product, it's about transforming your relationship to the product itself, right? So when you think about the consumer and the consumer's role, consumers just want products to work better. Mm-hmm. I don't know that they care that the device is necessarily connected to the internet. I think we've decided what devices we want connected to the internet, and there's not a lot of growth in that space. So we want our television, we want our computers, we want, you know, these other devices, mobile phones and whatnot, to be connected to the internet. I don't know that the consumer really cares that the device is connected to the internet. I think what they care about is, can the device be updated so the device performs better over the lifespan of the device? And I think as a producer of a device, I care about, do I have any visibility into that device when that device has already been deployed? So if I go out and I buy a collection of lithium-ion batteries or lithium polymer batteries, and I stick that into my product, and then I have some feedback from that product. You know, if you think about this from, sorry to take this sort of off the rails a bit, but if you think about this from purely a product lifecycle management sort of workflow, if you look at big enterprise customers that roll out big product lifecycle management systems, what's interesting in them is that none of those systems are actually kitted out to have a feedback loop from the product, yet that's the sort of widest view that anybody has about their product as a company deploying their products. Or going through the design and manufacturing phase of their product. So we can go all the way through to sticking a shipping label on a box and sending the box out to the consumer, but we don't have any feedback beyond that point. I think what it's raised for us as a software company, and for myself as somebody who's built IoT hardware before but now works at a software company, is there's this real need to provide that feedback loop that allows me to tie the design process all the way through to the deployment of the product. So this notion that the product can be out in the field and I can find out how frequently does a customer actually recharge its batteries? Or how frequently does a customer, you know, this is one of those things which famously happened in the laptop world. People were sort of always operating under the assumption that a customer charged their laptop, then they unplugged it, then they walked away and they used their laptop until the battery was depleted. And at some point it was suddenly an awakening that customers actually leave their laptop plugged in all the time, which then changed the way in which we actually design laptops to be able to respond to a different use model. Now, a laptop is obviously one of those devices that we make the assumption that it's already connected to the internet, but there's a whole lot of other consumer devices for which I would like feedback. I'd like to know whether or not the batteries are failing in a device. I'd like to take my vendor to task if a device is failing under certain circumstances, or the data that I'm getting back is gibberish. And I think there's an important leap which needs to be made between the software systems that we use for designing, producing, manufacturing those products, and then the feedback loop from that product back into that system. So I would, as an electrical engineer, love to know how my product behaves under all myriad of customer circumstance. I don't currently have visibility into that. And you know, candidly, I don't know that the consumer really cares whether the device is IoT enabled or not. I think there's a lot of fanfare. It's very hand wavy. But I think the opportunity there is to build a better user experience through the ability to do things like remote firmware updates, continue to improve the product as the product is out in the field, continue to get the customer data and the customer analytics and then be able to respond to that. And I think we don't have a good system for that these days. I mean, you can ask anybody who's built hardware. Almost everyone will say that they've built a system for deploying firmware to their device. Okay, well, why is that, right? Why isn't that just a new part of the standard form? Like, we all just have a system for deploying firmware. We sort of accept that there's one process for doing that. I think there's just so much independent energy or independence in thought and activity that we don't really have a cohesive thing there. I think on the industrial IoT side, sorry to sort of take this in that direction, but you know, on the industrial IoT side, I think it's perhaps a little more conspicuous what the opportunities are. But I'm not sure that there's huge room for disruption there, considering that the industrial internet is run by PLC controllers, or the industrial equipment is all run by PLC controllers, which are by definition connected. And so, you know, I don't want to sound disparaging towards the whole IoT play, but you know, I don't know that there is going to be mass adoption as you know, an answer to your question. I think it's one of those where we're going to see incremental growth, and it's going to be a steady incremental growth rather than some big exponential curve, which is actually going to happen.
And I gotta step in. So part of me says it's going to be a real jagged growth because of the very issues that you were talking about. So on one hand, it'd be nice to know or to design a battery that's used to be plugged in, you know, 12 hours a day instead of the expected, we take it here and run it all down. However, if I'm then turning around and tracking what it is that I'm doing with that, then you start to get this invasion of privacy, the security standpoint of it. What else is there? I mean, one of the things that I was reading an article in the last couple of weeks, it was talking about the new Samsung and LG refrigerators, how there's actually a camera that's in the refrigerator. How much milk do I have left? You know, they can.
Oh, I thought they were just proving whether or not the light was actually on or off.
That's right. That was one of the considerations as well.
Like, Schrodinger's fridge.
But they also turned around and pointed out that do I really want Samsung to know that I'm out of milk? Or you know, yeah, they can tell me that, and then similarly, there was the court case where they were talking about the Amazon Echo that you were talking about, you know, Alexa. You know, what was the last thing I asked Alexa? If I asked her about something that I didn't want the wife to know about, is that accessible? I don't know. We go off in that whole trust area. So
can I just want to build off, I think one of the common things that Bill is saying and Matt's saying is what's the value to the consumer of the device? Is this device really exciting? Is this fridge with a camera great? I would boil down, so your question I think is, you know, why is there not a wave of consumer IoT? I think there's a couple things in there, but it all comes down to two numbers. The first number is the product lifetime, and then the related to that is the replacement rate. So when you say, you know, we haven't seen this wave of consumer IoT, what you're really trying to say is, I have a sense of how quick markets move and how fast the smartphone market moved. You know, I saw we went from cell to smartphone super duper fast. And why? And everyone expected, we had this innate sense that similar trends would happen if we connected our phones. Why doesn't it happen when we connect our fridge? And the answer, in my opinion, is it's all about product lifetime. And so when you look at smartphones, the number is three. 3 years is the typical lifetime for a smartphone. And most people only replace their device. Most people just buy replacement devices. The people in this room are the exception. A lot of us have probably decided to throw out something that's perfectly working and go buy the IoT version because we're curious. But the rest of the world out there, they wait till their phone dies. And so if you have a 3-year product lifetime, that means that every year, 1/3 of the market, 33%, changes over. And so within 3 years, like you can see that we've had huge amounts of change in the smartphone market. By contrast, when you're talking about like a fridge, you're looking at products that have a 15, 20-year lifetime. And you guys are talking about the IoT product could be great. It could totally be great, but it's like a tree falling in the woods. No one's there to buy it because they're waiting till their old fridge just dies. So a 15-year product lifetime, that translates to about a 5% replacement rate every year. So I think fundamentally, regardless of how great we build our IoT devices, you can't compete with that like market physics, if you will, that no one's there to buy it because the existing installed base just lasts so much longer than smartphones.
So that's a great point. And then I had a question, actually, again, at Bill. Something that's hampering potentially that adoption cycle is the basically the spate of hacking attacks we've seen as a result of pretty poorly built consumer IoT products. And I know back in the room you mentioned that you were actually one of the people that detected the Mirai botnet earlier. From your perspective, like, why did that happen? Like, how did we manage to create not only not great products, but now literally malicious products? And what other things are we doing wrong in IoT design or how we think about new product development that we should really be thoughtful about?
That was one of the areas that I was struggling with as far as, you know, how do you, the bottom line is that there is, in my opinion, currently there is no device that is totally safe. So what you have to do is you have to protect yourself. You protect yourself by the fact that, like, it came out last month, the university, their soda machine basically got infected with malware. The soda machine was just there to keep track of the inventory. It's time to order more Coke syrup, time to order more, you know, Dr. Pepper syrup, whatever, to dump into the machine, whatever else. But what happened is it turned around and it got infected and infected the entire campus. And every 15 minutes, I think it was the number that we were just talking about, it was like 500 DNS requests. And it was for somebody that was looking to travel back home to the Philippines. It was a Philippine student that was at the college and he wanted to, so it was these distributed denial of service attacks that basically because of a soda machine, I'm going, so I think number one, you have to turn around, you have to do good isolation within your home. I was just talking with a good friend of mine that was telling me about the design of the new car shop. He's saying we want three different nets within, you know, three different subnets within a car dealership. And I go, three, what are they doing? Well, one of them, and we haven't gotten there, but they discovered that when that Tesla first came out, that it was virtually infinitely hackable. I think they found out 100 entry points to get into the software for it, to where I could theoretically drive the car off without you even in it, so which is a little bit scary. So the design has to be done, I think, initially, to where security is the number one. Number two is then ease of use. So you have to do things like rotating keys, whatever. Like there was the simple deal, I could go to a garage sale and buy a remote control. And what the bad guys were doing was running down the street, hitting the button. My garage opens up. Well, now what they've got is you get a new garage door opener and they have rolling codes. Great improvement, but still not perfect. There's virtually, I think, no way to keep everybody all the time out of your device. So it's a matter of design with security to begin with, design for isolation, and know your audience. I mean, something simple, like they had the thing, the Barbie doll that was internet enabled. It was, oh my God. And then to add on the price, like I was the one that brought it up, the Samsung and LG refrigerators, you know, it's a 15-year, 5%. That sounds like a pretty good number, you know, rotation rate for type thing. So it's, I'd like the information like you had, Matt, saying, let's get the feedback, be able to update that thing. What can I do to improve it on the fly? But then similarly, do I want that invasion of privacy? And how much privacy can I expect out of it? So I turn around, I go, what about this? To get back to the cars, they wanted one for the customer's cars, because what happens if my Tesla is infected and your Tesla or Chevy Cruze or whatever, anything with an internet spot, is got some malware in it? Can I send it to the other vehicle? And I think that's going to be the, my suspicion is you will read that in the news this year. That's my grand prediction for 2017, is one car infected another car. So the point is, they want one for the customer's cars, one for the shop, and possibly even one for the customers that come in and want to use their potentially infected laptop, computers, phones, whatever, to do that sort of thing. So the design is critical. To get back to answer the question, to talk security first, the implementation second is to isolate this stuff so you can keep it from crossing paths where you don't want it.
Yeah, if I'm a company or a dealership with a systems administrator, I think that's a reasonable ask, but if I'm just someone upgrading my fridge, it's hard to ask someone to isolate a virtual network for their fridge, right? That's kind of a absurd ask. Like, what as customers, well, so in this audience we have customers and we have engineers, like, what as customers can we be smarter about? And then on the engineering side, what should we stop taking for granted?
Wow.
Question, by the way.
Yeah, I'd have to start in the neighborhood of you can't take anything for granted, mm-hmm. as far as being secure. And on the customer side, I'd be tempted to isolate my own devices. I know my son goes crazy with it when he was at the house. All right, which one am I supposed to connect to now, type thing? You know, and I need things after Disney characters. So am I connecting to Flounder this time or Sebastian? Or you know, we did a complete Disney theme. And what ended up happening was that I have isolated that, and I think virtually any basic consumer wireless router in the house at least comes with two channels. At the very least, split your stuff up. I'm going to do my homework and computer work through, you know, point A. I'm going to do my IoT stuff. I'm going to send my Alexa. I'm going to send my whatever through, you know, point B. And go ahead and use, like in my case, I have three wireless routers behind the wireless router that I got from AT&T, formerly SBC Global, formerly fill in the blank. But yeah, so I'd do that. As far as the business, I don't know. Even then, some of the Cisco has been in trouble. Juniper's been in the news, all for, once again, sloppy. You know, deal. You have to program for security and test it, exercise it. What's it take? Some basic things that people can do, and I think they'd be totally amazed, is that there are several tools that are available for most people to say, what is it putting out? If I'm a designer, much like on the stuff that you graded, I was looking at it the other day on the website and saying, hey, this is cool. But what I ended up with is I would spend more time, if I was at that level, turning around and do I trust, like the, what was it? The stuff that we've got cooking, an awful lot of people are contracting this stuff overseas. When it comes back, when you get that prototype, have you taken a look at the code? If you're not looking at the code or you're not putting a sniffer on it to see what's going around, you get what you paid for.
Well, and I think it's interesting. I think there's something hidden in all of that, which I kind of want to bring to the surface, which is the idea that, you know, as a consumer, I really want to understand what my device communicates and how it communicates. I don't think we have any visibility into that today. And I think it's one of those things which is actually an unrealized opportunity. I think we have stuff for all of us as technologists, right? I can go into Wireshark and I can watch packets fly around my network and all sorts of interesting things. But I don't think the average consumer has any visibility into that. Where I think I think there is a threat to IoT, which isn't about security, but which is about the practical reality of when I experience a degradation in the quality of internet service to my house, am I going to start pointing the finger at all of those connected devices that I have around my house? My video camera, my refrigerator, my toaster, my this, my that. All of a sudden, we start looking at those things and saying, well, you know, previously I could get 4K out of Netflix, but now I'm running at 1280. Mm-hmm. what's the, you know, what device is actually doing it? And the truth is if you ask the average consumer, they'd have no visibility into that. So I think there needs to be, and I think this speaks also to the security component of this, there needs to be transparency in terms of what's being transmitted, how frequently is it being transmitted, because the only way that a consumer is going to know if the device is behaving nefariously is if they have some baseline to measure that.
To measure, yes.
And we don't have any of that today. So in the absence of that, I think we're actually in a really vulnerable spot. But the opportunity is there for somebody to step in and say, okay, we need to create a standard for how you can describe what the expected communications would look like. And we need to build the security in there to be able to understand how we can compare the actual network traffic with the expected network traffic as well.
And that would be actually a good way to essentially to go to the next step, because at this point, the only thing that we can do, at least myself as a developer, is essentially to use a kind of a defensive move. So actually hire one of the companies that is going to come and hack your system and identify all the possible weaknesses in your system. And then, you know, go back to my semiconductor provider, says, you know, oh, you didn't put a key there, you didn't put another protection there, and so on. And while establishing some kind of standard, some kind of procedure that allow us to secure, number one, transparency, as you were saying, number two, essentially, full security for what we are communicating, I think that would be very good. But it's a new frontier. Mm-hmm. From my point of view.
Well, so this entire conversation actually hinges around another assumption which I want to ask about, which is we're connecting over Wi-Fi, right? And Wi-Fi isn't great, and I'm sure a lot of you here are struggling to even connect to the conference Wi-Fi. None of the mesh protocols we've seen or those consortiums have really seen mass adoption for a variety of reasons. But this year at CES, I was walking around and all the chip companies have MBIoT, like dev kits out. It's a lot of people experimenting with unlicensed spectrum. And the power to trade off issue is real. And Wi-Fi and Bluetooth are at best kind of hacky solutions. And so actually, Mike, I'm curious to hear what you have to say, because you sit pretty close to a telecom. How do you all see the future of IoT connectivity shaking out? Because listen, if I'm still connecting my devices over Wi-Fi in 5 years, I'm going to be pretty upset at all of you.
Sure. So Orange is a telecommunications company. I work for Orange. If you're not familiar with it, just think of AT&T and Verizon, but for Europe. And so I think the short answer is Orange is actively working on solving your problem, so you'll be okay within 5 years, Kane. But no, I think it's kind of like, the question is, where are we, why are we here, and where do we need to go? So where we are right now, most connected devices are either using Wi-Fi or cell. Mm-hmm. And there's a handful of other, in order to get to the internet, so I'm not going to worry about the Bluetooths of the world yet, but the problem with Wi-Fi and cell is that they were designed for the laptop and the smartphone use case, and people love their smartphones. And they're willing to put in tons of money and tons of effort to keep them internet connected. So we pay for a monthly data plan with our phones. We'll get, you know, like you were just referencing, everybody comes into a new place. The first thing they say is, can I get your Wi-Fi password? And we're constantly charging our devices. That works totally fine with our smartphones, but it completely breaks with IoT, because we like our IoT devices, but we don't love them. And so no one wants to pay for an expensive monthly data plan. We'll get the device on Wi-Fi once, maybe twice, but we're not going to do it repeatedly like we would with the other devices, and we don't want to charge it all the time. So you have this trade-off where we've built these networks expecting that we're going to charge the devices all the time, people are going to pay all this money, put in all this effort, and IoT breaks that. But there's one special thing about IoT, and to your point about Netflix, it's very rare, I think. Most IoT devices don't do video. Most of them don't even do audio. The typical IoT device tells you the door is open, the light is on, and it's red. So instead of talking about gigabytes of video or megabytes of audio, we're looking at less than kilobyte-sized data packets. And that's where you that's where narrowband IoT fits in, and a bunch of other competing solutions are coming into the market today. So at Orange, we're one of the unlicensed spectrum solutions that you were just referring to. One of them is called LoRa, L-O-R-A. L-O is long, R-A is range. So Orange, last year, we just deployed a LoRa network in about 100 cities in France. And we're extending that network. And we're also looking at narrowband LTE and a number of solutions. But so the short answer is, I think there is a consensus in the industry that it's too hard to get IoT devices connected to the internet. And it's really hard for me to say which of them is going to win. Is it going to be narrowband LTE? Is it going to be Sigfox? Is it going to be LoRa? It's a standards war, so it's really hard to pick, you know, who's going to win, Betamax or VHS. The answer is, you know, try them all and let the market kind of shake things out. But the thing that I think that you'll see in 5 years, when things hopefully go right, is you're going to go to Home Depot or wherever you want to get your IoT device. It's already going to be internet connected. It's already going to either be using narrowband LTE or LoRa or something to be on the network. And when you unbox it, it'll have some kind of unique code so that you can claim it, that this is Kane's device. And away you go. And it'll be that simple. And everyone will be a lot happier.
So to address that, I think a little bit of it's going to get worse before it gets better because of that very complaint that you had, is that in order to increase the smartphone throughput to be able to watch that video, the one of the things they were saying was that these for the March Madness, that 30% of it was being watched on a portable device. This is wireless, but what they've come out with, and I hadn't been paying that close attention to it, was the so-called LTEU to expand that. However, the way they're expanding that, Verizon's introducing it, and Los Angeles, and it seems to me five different markets. But the way that they're doing that is they're stealing part of the same band that Wi-Fi sits on. So I think temporarily, while Verizon does its experiment, I'm sure AT&T is hot on its heels and everything else, you're gonna see a degradation of some of your IoT stuff because of the expanded cell phone use. So it's, I don't know. And then it's the whole argument of a spectrum. It's absolutely amazing. Once a year, I get every 4 years, I think it is, they talk about the spectrum at the ITU, International Telegraphic Union, that talks about who gets to use what in which countries. And it's an amazing process. And I know as an amateur radio operator that we're in there saying we want this, and some of the interesting devices that have come out for passing stuff has come from the amateur radio community of people that are one of the guys that got me involved in the microwave on ham radio up at the 2.3 GHz was amazing. Worked for Hewlett Packard for years in the microwave division. That's where an awful lot of experiment. So how much of that do you take away from the amateur radio community? How much do you give for the experimental design? That's a whole different can of worms that you could probably go on for 2 hours for in a totally different discussion. So I don't know. But to get back to the original statement, I think it's going to get worse before it gets better.
Well, I want to get back to that. But in the time we have left, I do want to change the subject real fast. Carlo, as the bravest panelist, having now gone off and started your own company, I would love to hear, and I'm sure the entrepreneurs in the room would as well, what trends and services are you seeing to enable rapid, cheap prototyping? Because I imagine the cost for building your product is very different than the cost TI took on decades ago when they had to build their first product.
Yeah, compared to many years ago, some years ago, today there are a lot more tools to prototype new products. The one that's, of course, you can think about, all the 3D printing, of course, is very easy, accessible. You have engineers all around, you know, to come out, you know, with the development of the prototype. Even programming tools are a lot more effective today. We are working also with universities. We are working with UC Berkeley, Stanford, and the two universities in Italy. And this allows us actually to explore also this artificial intelligence, you know, area in order to identify the event of an accident. So yes, there are plenty of tools, and actually it's even difficult sometimes to find the right direction. It's probably more difficult to find, you know, who is the right person to work with, or the right organization, the right tool to find, and then essentially to say, okay, there is a tool for that. Okay, so the other things that I think that is also challenging is essentially the fact that until some time ago, there was pretty good distinction between software, hardware, who was, you know, people was doing software, people were doing hardware, people who are more digital guys, people who are more analog guys, and things like this. The more you compress your product, the more you go towards the IoT, the more all these kind of competencies they start to merge. And the people, they need to understand each other. So it's not anymore the time that, you know, you have the digital guy, you know, moving the problem on the hardware guy, say, okay, okay, the hardware is going to solve this, or the other way around, you know, the software guy is going to say, the software guy is going to solve that. So now the competencies, so it's, what is really difficult today is to find the right mindset and the right engineers that essentially can understand all of them and can merge technology and concentrate everything in a very small devices at this point. Okay, so that is actually probably the more difficult part, you know, finding, you know, good designing companies, some cases, or competencies or engineers that have that kind of capabilities.
What was the most difficult part of creating your product? Was it finding a contract manufacturer? Was it finding a PCB assembler? Was it finding someone to do low volume runs? Like, as you think through the process, what areas are still?
Of course, for every startup, of course, mm-hmm. the number one challenge is always resources, right? So no matter what, if they are financial, if they are competencies, if they are, you know, people, time, whatever, resources, the very first challenge by definition. When you start to go technical, in our case, we want to be very disruptive in technology. You know, integrating a very small satellite modem in such a small device, it was extremely challenging. So we had to find specific competencies of satellite antenna designers, you know, that we could find only in Europe for some reason. This guy has designed antenna that are in this moment on Mercury, essentially, right? And so competencies. People can, you know, can really design in that kind of field. Artificial intelligence is also another area where essentially you don't find that many professionals in that area for the, you know, for the development of the algorithms and all these kind of things. So of course, people, competence, great engineers, and the coordination of something that also is international, right? So this one are the bigger challenges for me.
And so I see you've clearly already started your company, but for the rest of the year, if I were to force you to start a company, what opportunities are you seeing that are still unexploited, given the state of connectivity, rapid prototyping, all the capabilities we have now and represented outside? Mm-hmm. What would you start if you had to start a new company, or if you guys were to quit and start something from scratch?
So I'll take that pitch. I think the
I'm just trying to make my job easier.
Absolutely. No, I think there's an enormous amount of disruption happening at the level of manufacturing, and I think it's not well understood. I think there's, of course, some aspects of it which are really hand wavy. If you told me that there was another FDM printer in the world, I probably wouldn't be that interested. But at the same time, if you look at the work that's being done for the construction of scaffolds and 3D prints of metal materials to take weight out of something and add strength back to it, the things that we can do with additive manufacturing, not 3D printing in the conventional FDM sense, but the things that we can do with additive manufacturing, specifically around metals, are things that we couldn't build a cast or a mold for at all. And I think in those cases, there's some interesting stuff which is happening in the manufacturing world, which is probably hugely disruptive. I know that doesn't really fit with the IoT theme, But I think in terms of technology, I think there's a lot of disruption which is happening there. I think where we get success at the IoT level is actually going to come more from looking at this as what would we internetwork. So if I build something which is a smoke detector which is connected to a lighting system and connected to the HVAC system, then when we detect smoke, we recognize that there's a fire, we can light a path to the exit, and we can control the HVAC system to pipe smoke the other direction. That's interesting. There's a lot of people in really tall buildings spread all through the developing world right now who would love the ability to find a path outside of a building. Add to that proximity detection and temperature detection and or temperature sensing, and you've got the makings of a pretty interesting comprehensive system which benefits from the aggregate of data, right? I think likewise, if you look at something like connecting together lights on a roadway, and you say, okay, if those lights from 2 a.m. until 5 a.m. between LA and Palm Springs, as those trucks start making their way down the highway, they really only need to light the three lights in front of it and the three lights behind it. So, you know, if we can replace those 1,000-watt high-pressure sodium lamps with lighting which can actually follow a truck as it moves down the highway, that's interesting. So I think the opportunities are there in the IoT space. I don't know that they exist at the consumer level.
Got it.
I want to build off what you're saying, Matt. So I, when you say, like, if I could build anything in IoT, what would it be? What would my next company be? To use the cliche, I like to think of like IoT 1.0 and IoT 2.0. And to me, IoT 1.0 is, let's take what we're already measuring and let's IoTify it. Let's take our smoke detector and connect it to the internet, and now what? And I think the majority of the devices that I've seen in that are IoT today are IoT 1.0. We've already been doing it. Let's stick some extra sensors and connectivity in there, IoTify it, and hopefully it'll sell more. The thing that I'm really interested in is the IoT 2.0, where we've never measured it before. And my kind of canonical example of that is the Fitbit HR. And so what's really interesting with the Fitbit HR, if you haven't seen Fitbit HR, it measures your heart rate, right? So, but what's the paradigm shift? So up until very recently, if you had some kind of heart condition, you would go to the doctor, they take a really, really, really accurate measurement, and then you'd go away for weeks or months, and then they take another really accurate measurement. And that's the paradigm that we're used to. There's this phenomenon that we care about, we measure it really precisely, but totally infrequently, and most of the time we're in the dark. The miracle of IoT is we can use cheap sensors, take crappy but good enough measurements all the time, continuously. And your colleague, Avidan, was talking about like the value of the data set. And now all of a sudden, we're able to understand things that we could never understand before. We don't have to hope that, you know, in the 2 months between my heart rate measurement, that my heart rate was roughly the same as those two, as those, you know, measurements on the edge.
Actually, not to rush you, but I'm sure. Going to rush you just because I saw the time warning and I want to leave questions. So 30 seconds and then 40 seconds, 40 seconds, just so we get everyone's word in.
Sure. So in conclusion, I think measuring things I've never measured before, heart rate is not the most high value thing to measure, but I think creating those new tools, that's what I find the most exciting.
For what it regards me, of course, we already made our bet in this moment. For us, you know, there is an incredible value in making the world safer, especially for people. So our bet is essentially, you know, to make more efficient as possible to rescue people in a potential accident or in any other dangerous situation. We start from sports, but essentially we think that individuals can be protected better.
Awesome. Bill?
Wow. So for me, and in looking at it, it was one of those things to where I agree with Matt as far as we need feedback for design of these things. However, to take it a step further, and my suspicion is that it'd be an IoT 3.0, if you will, to go back and to establish, like Matt was saying, exactly what it is I'm sending back and to have it trustable. Very simple.
Well, so we have a few minutes left. If anyone has specific questions for anyone that spoke related to any of their areas of expertise. Yes.
I was here for an earlier session where they talked about data and data being collected and used. And I didn't hear any of that with regard to the IoT.
Yes. For us, data is very much important. As I said, you know, we have an artificial intelligence algorithm, and so we have a typical machine learning approach for the recognition of the accident. So it's very important for us to collect all the data. It's essentially to keep training the algorithms at the different level of the users. So it's one of the bigger problems that we are solving. Because of course we need to organize them, we need to collect them, we have to analyze them, and make sure that essentially we have a device that is capable to identify the accident in the most accurate possible way. And, you know, it's a key differentiator for us, because on the contrary of the other crash sensor, we have this biomechanic analysis of the user, and that is essentially very important for us. Then what else we can do with this data, I don't know. But we think that, you know, we can actually extract even more information than that.
See, and it gets back to the trust thing. It's what data do you have? Can I trust you with it?
Well, and I think there's a wide collection of data. What would you do with aggregated data? Right? What would you do if you had a lot of data from a lot of different devices? Because then you can make assumptions about performance, you can make assumptions about all sorts of usage, that sort of thing. Then I think the other component of that is what does a system benefit from how does the system benefit when you take the aggregate of data from multiple different sources and put it together? And that's a smoke detector example, right? The idea that if you had data from a variety of different sensory inputs, what would you actually do with that in aggregate? That you couldn't do with that stuff independently. And that's, I think, the other part of that, which is really interesting.
I was curious about how Orange monetizes LoRa. It looks like LoRa is free.
Yep. So the question was how Orange monetizes LoRa, the assumption being it's free right now?
So great question. So how do we monetize LoRa? I'd say the short answer is we're still figuring out the right business models. There's no like fixed answer that I know of, but I think to start with, it's let's just get people using it, understand how it creates value, and then we can take it from there.
Go from there.
Great. Well, I think that's all the questions, and I know we're the only thing between you guys and happy hour, so enjoy happy hour.
Let's be happy.
And thanks to the awesome panelists and Beth for hosting. Yeah.